Hey guys, welcome to the Smart Venture Podcast. In each episode, we're going to have conversations with some of the top investors, superstar founders, as well as well-known tech company executives in Silicon Valley. We'll have a coffee chat with them to learn their way of thinking and actionable tips on how they build or invest in a successful company. Before we start our show today, I want to make sure the listener, aka you, understand that everything a person say on the podcast only reflects hers or his own opinion, not the show or the company they work at. Our guest today is a VP of product at Coinbase. Prior to Coinbase, he was a general manager at Airbnb, where he led a cross-functional team managing product management, engineering, design, and other functions for Airbnb Plus. Prior to Airbnb, he spent time at Facebook and Instagram, where he founded and led Instagram shopping products, amongst other product areas. His name is Sanchan S. Saxena. Welcome to the show, Sanchan.
I'm excited to be here and thank you for inviting me.
You have a quite successful career. You are now the VP of Coinbase. You've worked on iconic companies like Airbnb and Instagram. To start the show, I'd love to go back to your childhood a little bit. You were originally from India. You studied aerospace engineering. You tried entrepreneurship. You've worked at big tech companies like Microsoft and Yahoo. Now you're in Silicon Valley. To start off the show, can you share with us how you started and how you got to where you are today?
Yeah, happy to. I came to the US in 2007. Actually, I came to Silicon Valley in 2007. I came to the US in 2005. In Silicon Valley, as you mentioned, I've been very fortunate to have worked with some great founders and some great companies, and I've learned a lot during that time. But it wasn't always a straight line from where I was born and where I was raised and where I grew up. I will take us back in time when I lived in the small town called Saharanpur in India. Mm-hmm. And fun fact, I did not know how to speak in English until the age of like 11 or 12. I did not know, because I studied in schools that taught math and science in local languages. So it was a fun upbringing, you know, where I learned everything in local languages. And then I moved to this big town called New Delhi, which is the capital of India. And that is when I first got introduced to, okay, everything has to be in English. You need to learn the second language. And that's when I picked up the second language. But it was a journey. And then I think my inclination growing up was to always, I was fascinated by space. I remember in high school, in the summer vacations after high school, my dad bought me a book called The Brief History of Time by Stephen Hawking. And that really mesmerized me about what space is and what astrophysics is and what these physicists do. So I actually got galvanized by that and started thinking about how can I build a career in space. Now, back in the day, there was only one employer. There was no Elon Musk, you know, so nobody was building SpaceX, et cetera. If you wanted to be in aerospace or you wanted to do anything around that, you needed to work for NASA or something like that. And it was fun, but I decided to pivot in my third year of engineering and start my own company. I was bitten by the so-called entrepreneurial bug at that time. I was fascinated about what was happening in the market. And by the way, this is all back in India. So I'm reading this information from Silicon Valley secondhand. I'm not here. But I was always inspired by how a small idea backed by a bunch of believers can go on to change the world. And that idea galvanized me to start taking some risk of my own as well. So in my third year of engineering, I took a little bit of sabbatical to build a company. It didn't go anywhere, but it was good learning, you know. I always tell people that your failures will teach you more than your successes will. And that was a great learning for me as well. And that honed the hustle in me, the ability to lead with them when there is a lot of ambiguity. All of that stuff that a founder typically faces when they start a company is what I learned during that time. And then once I was bitten by that, I was always looking for what do I do next, you know, now that I've wrapped up my company. And by the way, when I wrapped up my company, my mom was very happy. She's like, okay, you got a stable job now. You know, I got a job at Microsoft. She was very happy about that. You know, she's like, I don't know, this startup thing, whether it'll work out or not, but now you're at Microsoft. Things are good. And I learned a lot at Microsoft as well. One of the best early jobs you can get back in 2003, 2004, 2005, when you come out of college and you're like, all right, I can learn a lot from this company. And I did a lot of learning. And as part of that, I came to the US. And since then, I have been in Silicon Valley. And all I would say is that it's been the only genius thing I've done in my career is to come to Silicon Valley. The rest is everything happenstance. So it's been fun coming over here and meeting with great founders, working with really great employees and building a career.
Yeah, absolutely. That was super cool. You tried entrepreneurship early on. During that time, did you find out your strength is in product? How did that evolve into your successful product career?
Yeah, I think in my career, I was always galvanized by the idea of the different things that need to be solved to make a product or a business successful. Mm-hmm. So I started in engineering, but slowly I started gravitating towards understanding what marketing is and the role that marketers play in making a product successful. And by the way, just to be very clear, in Silicon Valley, there is a myth that all it takes is just great engineering. Yes, that is an important mm-hmm. element of a product success, but it takes a set of highly talented, dedicated, cross-functional partners across marketing. And if you have mm-hmm. sales, that too, PR, product management, engineering, design, data science, all of them to collectively build great products. And what I found early on in my career was that amongst the center of this collaboration, PM plays a big role. So in 2007, I transitioned from engineering into product. And since then, I've been in product. It has suited my personality. It has suited mm-hmm. what I truly enjoy and gives me energy, which is looking at problems from all angles and collaborating mm-hmm. with different specialists like marketers or PR people or product managers and engineers and designers to come up with the right solution for the customer. And that junction where all of these things collide and then the magic happens, that is the place that I enjoy the most. And that's where I think product managers find them most often in that sweet spot. So since then, I've been in product management.
Yeah, absolutely. You are super articulate. You seem really social and easy to talk to. I feel like being empathetic, being able to work with different functions and putting product together is definitely really fun. What is one skill that you're constantly trying to get better at as a former entrepreneur or people work at big tech company?
Yeah, happy to answer this. And this is one of my constant focus areas for the last 10 years, but I've tried to constantly be aware of what should I grow into? What should I learn? What should I improve on? And what I found is this interesting junction. I call it the yin and yang of personal growth. And let me explain what I mean by that. I find that it's easier for people, including myself, to pick up a skill. For example, you want to learn coding, you want to learn Python, how to code in Python. Maybe you can pick that up mm-hmm. by putting in enough effort and putting in enough dedication. And you can build that skill. But I think what I've learned is that over time, the real success differentiator for me was managing the yin and yang of my own personality. So let me explain that a little bit, what I mean by that. I believe if you want to truly be a founder or build a company that changes the world, you got to have a little bit of overconfidence. Because if you don't have that, you're going to be dismayed by all the obstacles you're going to get mm-hmm. into. For example, there'll be more people telling you this idea is a bad idea. There'll be more failures than successes. And if you don't have that, a little bit of overconfidence in your own abilities to mm-hmm. go still pursue that in the face of everybody telling you it's not going to work, you're not going to be a great successful founder, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. But at the same time, that same exact founder, or that same exact executive also have to depict something which is exactly the opposite of it, which is humility. Because if you're not humble enough, you're going to be living in hubris. You're going to be thinking about everything that's in your head. So how do you, as an executive or a founder or an employee of any career stage, how do you manage these yin and yang personality traits has been a great revelation for me as well, growing up in the last 10 years. And I constantly look at, okay, how do I manage this confidence that I can change the world, I can build something amazing, with the humility that is required to know that you can be wrong, with the humility to understand there are other perspectives that could be better than yours. And I think that's my constant journey as an individual, that how do I balance them yin and yang? And I think I don't have a playbook for that, but I think I'm getting better every single day. You know, I'm getting better every single day by having that balance.
Yeah, that's so philosophical. Sometimes you need to be confident in what you do, but also be humble enough to listen to your customer, learn about their problems that you're trying to solve. It's so important to have both abilities. I totally agree with what you said. You have quite a successful career. You've worked at iconic companies. Who is on your personal board of advisors when it comes to career development?
Yeah, great question. I think the number one person on that list is my wife. You know, my wife is my best friend, and my wife is also probably my best advisor as well. And there are more people as well, I think, but let me start there and then I'll add more. So I think one of the best decisions or the biggest decision one has to make, at least in my perspective, is who you spend the rest of your life in. And I think I won the lottery ticket on that. You know, I won the lottery ticket in the sense that my wife is a great mentor, a great coach, and a great partner, a thought partner in how we think about things. So I always go to her. You know, when I took the Airbnb job, I wasn't sure if I should take that. And I went to her and had a long conversation with her, and she helped me think through what truly matters to me and why that job will be the great job. Same thing with the Coinbase role as well. So that's one big board of advisors for me. She advises me in all things from how to raise our kids and how to be a good dad, all the way to what job I should pursue. So she's played a big role. The other is I have a mentor as well who I've worked with for many years, and he has helped me think through the growth trajectory of mine as well, like personal growth trajectory, where I want to grow. People always talk about, you know, what is your single thing that you're trying to optimize for in product land. I have a similar saying from my personality as well, which is the single thing that I'm trying to optimize for is to be the fastest learner in the room. And what I mean by that is if I'm optimizing for that aspect, I'm constantly growing and I'm constantly seeking opportunities that will challenge and grow me even further. So this mentor of mine is a great person to go to, and he pushes me. He pushes my buttons sometimes as well to make me feel like, okay, am I thinking about this problem the right way or not? And having a person that you confide in, having a person that you have trust in and you can be vulnerable is a big, big asset in my opinion. So yeah, between my wife and this mentor, I've been very lucky to have the right set of people or board of advisors rather who will help me continue to grow.
Yeah, totally. I'm curious, is your wife also in tech? Does she like, I mean, how do you pick the board of advisor? Like what characteristic do you look for and how do you build that relationship with them?
Yeah, I think for me personally, I've always been attracted to the opposites. Meaning if what I mean by that is, like my wife and I are completely different. She's not an engineer. I'm an engineer. She's not in product. I'm in product. She is in Silicon Valley, but she was born and raised on the East Coast in New York. And then she moved over here after we started dating and got married. So she brings that East Coast personality as well, which is very different than the West Coast personality. So if you ever meet us, we are kind of same, but more or less we are opposites, you know, and the opposites amongst us attract each other. And I think that's the same thing I've found in my friends. That's the same thing I've found in the mentors I'm looking for. And I think my selection criteria has been what kind of energy. I'm a big seeker of energy. Let me explain this concept as well. So I organize my day around energy, you know, so when I wake up in the morning, I have a set routine. I will take a certain set of do a certain set of activities from working out to taking certain types of meetings in the morning to taking certain types of meetings in the afternoon and evening. And I like to manage my energy. And energy has been a big source of how I've managed my resiliency as well. I mean, when you work at Airbnb, Coinbase, Instagram, et cetera, these are hyper growth companies. And if you don't self-regulate your own energy, you're not going to thrive and you're not going to survive. And that's at least my belief. So I focus a lot on managing energy. So when I look at whether it's friends or a partner or a mentor, it's a very similar thing, which is I'm looking for that energy of connection, the energy where we can both be vulnerable with each other, where we can be honest and direct with each other. I don't want people who will BS me or will say stuff on my face, but say something else behind me because I'm a very direct person as well. So I'm looking for those people as well. In terms of beyond the energy piece, you know, you just have to click with that person. You know, you just have to find who that person is. And I always tell people this, you know, like everybody has this thinking, which is, hey, tell me a bullet list of things I should look for in my mentor or tell me how to do X. And they expect you to give them like a checklist. Okay, look for this, look for this, look for this. What I've found in my life is it's very hard to describe great things in bullet points. You know, you see, you have to experience greatness to understand what greatness even means. You know, and I think that is an incredibly important piece. So a lot of my answers, as you will notice, I am unable to tell people, even people who reach out to me for career advice, et cetera, is how to prescriptively do something because I don't have a checklist. I don't have a do X, Y, and Z, and you will get that outcome because I always believe great things can only be experienced and learned. So it's the same analogy over here. You got to spend time with that board of advisor, understand who they are, understand how the energies between you and that person interact and how honest and direct they will be with you when you need that advice as well. And from a functional and domain perspective, I rarely look for that. My mentor is actually not even from tech, and they advise me on things because they've seen life beyond tech and they've helped me stay grounded beyond tech. Because in Silicon Valley, for that matter, in any industry, you can have a lot of hubris in your head because you can have a lot of echo chamber kind of an environment where everybody's saying the same thing. And I feel like you miss out on the opportunity to grow. So I've intentionally chosen an advisor or a mentor who is outside of Silicon Valley, who's seen great scale, great successes, and can help me understand my blind spots, things that I'm not even aware of that I should be looking for.
Yeah, that's so interesting. When I think about mentors, I tend to find someone who achieved what I wanted to achieve, someone who are quote unquote similar to me instead of the opposite. From our conversation, I definitely feel like I need to seek people in different spaces with different personalities or experiences to show me my blind spot. Speaking of building a great product, you've worked on many iconic products and companies, Microsoft, Yahoo, Instagram, Airbnb, now Coinbase. All of these companies are in different industries. How do you learn about an industry really fast to build a successful product? What is the differences and similarities when it comes to creating successful products in different sectors?
Yeah, I think I've been very lucky to have had a chance to work with some incredible founders. I got a chance. I joined Instagram with, I think it was less than 100 employees, if I'm not wrong. Very, very tiny. And by the way, when I say 100 employees across the company, not just in engineering, product, and design. So it's a very small company. And I got a chance to work with Kevin's sister, Mike Krieger, during those times. And I learned a lot there. With Brian Chesky at Airbnb, I got to learn a lot from him. I would say a lot of my product thinking is probably influenced more by Brian Chesky than anybody else that I've worked with in my life. And now I'm at Coinbase, where I work with Brian Armstrong and Sarojit and a bunch of other folks as well. And I'm learning constantly around there. I think there are a couple of things that I've always found helpful when I've taken a new job. One is you got to start with the mindset that you are going to have to learn a lot. You know, there are two options you can take when you're an executive. You can show up at a company and say, hey, look, I've done this at X, Y, and Z. And let me show you how it's done, right? Because I've done it before, right? And that, I think, is a failed strategy. I think the best strategy is to come in with an open mind and try to be a sponge who can absorb all the nuances of every industry. While it is true that we are all in Silicon Valley, while it is true that we all are building tech companies, but there are nuanced differences that dictate each industry and also define the company culture that you are in. So that's number one priority in my head, is that I go in with a mindset that I'm going to learn with an open mind. Mm-hmm. And of course, I'm going to bring my toolkit as well that I've honed over many years at these other companies to the problem at hand. But I think that's very, very important. The other is finding in that company the what I call the source of truth people. So in every company, there are these experts. You know, there are people who've done really well in those companies, in those industries, and have a lot of information. And I like to just spend time, inordinate amount of time with them in those places. So I've done that successfully within the first 3 months. I'll just be attend every meeting, read every PRD, read every strategy doc, you know, understand all those things and be naive enough to ask questions. Oftentimes, the biggest mistake you can make when you join a company as an executive is like, you don't ask all the right questions. So understanding that is incredibly important as well. And when it comes to product management, I mean, I can go on this, but there's a lot of things I've learned. And I'm happy to share my lessons and what I've seen to be working.
Yeah, absolutely. I really like your humbleness and the continuous learning mindset. Even you're an exec of a company, you've done similar things in different companies. You still put yourself in the student seat, try to be a sponge, learning from experts in each industries. I love that growth mindset. PMing is one of the most competitive jobs to get into. From our private conversation before, you've worked with many iconic product leaders. As an expert yourself, if someone doesn't have an engineering background, wants to pursue a product career, how should they go about it? Also, there are so many product schools. I feel like they are great at teaching the tactics and interviewing skills, but what is the essence of building a great product? What's the core of the job?
Yeah. I think there's a huge interest in product management. By the way, 10, 12 years ago, like 2003, 4, 5, product management wasn't that cool of a job. Now I think it is becoming a cooler job. So lots of things to share over here. So first and foremost, let's start with what is the role of product? I think in Silicon Valley, broadly speaking, there are two schools of thought. Broadly speaking, there are many nuances as well, but broadly speaking, there are two schools of thought. One is the mini CEO school of thought, which says that you are the mini CEO of the product, which means that every decision is made by you. You are like the CEO. The problem with that school of thought is that I don't think that school of thought scales, in my opinion. And for many reasons, a couple of them are nobody reports to you, you know, so a CEO, everybody reports to, and you can fire somebody if you want, right? You can't do that as a product manager. You lead through influence. You don't lead through authority. It's a big difference. And also it creates a culture where it feels like all decisions must be made by PM. And the funny thing is PMs are generalists, they're not specialists. And if you want them to make all decisions, you're probably going to end up making equally bad ones as you would make equally good ones. The other school of thought on the other side of the spectrum is this. Well, here's what design does. Here's what engineering does. Here's what marketing does. And everything in between that's white space is what PMs do. Yes, I've heard that statement as well. Like someone drew this circle for me. Here's a circle for design. Here's a circle for engineering. Here's a circle for marketing. And everybody else, that PMs do everything else in between the white space. I think that's also a problematic school of thought, in my opinion, because if your job definition is by virtue of what others don't do, then you don't have a job definition. You don't really know what you're supposed to do. So these two extreme schools of thoughts I've heard a lot about, and I don't subscribe to either one of them. I think the reality, as always in life, is somewhere in the middle. They're never in extremes. And what is the middle here? I think the real way to think about this is that in my mind, product managers are first and foremost working backwards from the customer's need and are championing those needs. And let me explain that a little bit. And this is something we talked at length at Airbnb during the product management onboarding. By the way, when product managers will join on board, will onboard at Airbnb, I'll do a session with them to say, here's how Airbnb builds products. And this will be one of the top things we'll talk about is when that great product managers always work backwards from the customer. And our customers generally don't know what they need. That is not their job. They just know that they have a problem. And our job is to then figure out how to solve that problem for them. And and there are many ways to skin the cat, meaning you can talk about concepts like jobs to be done, framework. You can talk about problem solution framework. There are many ways to solve that problem. But at the end of the day, your job is to identify the right customer problems that we should focus on and then prioritize the work around that. And that is the biggest, big role that PMs play. The other thing that PMs do, in my opinion, is what I call influence without authority. So I think the closest probably why I ended up being in product is because as a founder, one of my roles was to also influence people to believe in the mission and the vision that I have and then bring them along in that journey. And I think that's a skill set that I have successfully transitioned into my product role as well, is where there's a vision, there is a belief in that vision, and my job is to influence others as well to believe in them. Now, just to be clear, it is not just the PM's job to do that, but predominantly a lot of that burden falls on the PM as well, to bring across a bunch of talented individuals from different teams, different organizations to believe in that mission and pursue that outcome for the customer as well. So I think those are broad strokes. I think we can go into details as well, but broad stroke, I would say that's how I would view the role of the product manager, which is not a mini CEO, which is not something that others don't do, hence you do kind of an analogy as well. And I think the great successful, most successful product managers that I've interacted with, whether at Instagram, Airbnb, or at Coinbase, et cetera, have been the ones who've taken this job very seriously. And there's certain traits I look for when I'm hiring product people. Mm-hmm. One is unconstrained thinking. Oftentimes, the argument in Silicon Valley is like, okay, what can we do? Well, we can do this because we have X, Y, and Z constraint. And Brian Chesky taught me this idea that, you know, you should always work backwards from an ideal end state first. The general thinking is let's work forward from an MVP. We have a high-level vision. You know, one slide for that vision. That's pretty much it. Now let's talk about the MVP. And the immediate reaction of many PMs is, all right, well, how many resources do I have? How much time do I have? What can I build in that time, right? And that's the general thinking you will see. But what Brian taught me was that you want to work backwards from an unconstrained vision first. Challenge all assumptions that you have today. Assumptions of your technology stack, assumptions of how many people you have, assumptions of time. And first and foremost to me, craft a vision of what's possible. What do we want to create for our users? The ideal end state vision. And I think Brian gets that because he came from an industrial design background, and you design the ideal product experience first, and then you figure out how to ship it later. And I think that's an incredibly important piece. So I'm looking for PMs who thrive in unconstrained thinking. You know, and they start with an unconstrained world. The second piece I look a lot for in PM partners that I work with, or whether it's in engineering design, but mostly in PM as well, is can they operate both in the ideation and scaling phase. So I've learned in my career that the ideation phase is a different skill set than a scaling phase, you know? And some people are really good at the ideation phase, but they suck when it comes to scaling. And some people are really good at scaling, but 0 to 1 is like very hard for them, right? So I think finding people who can tread that boundary is very exciting for me. And when I find that unicorn person, I'm like, all right, let's come work for me and we'll work together to build incredible products together.
Yeah, that's such an interesting framework to think about the job. You mentioned about creating a product at the ideation phase and scalable phase are very different. I assume it's probably not that hard to create a product for a niche group of people, but hard to scale that product to a bigger audience. What's the different skill sets do you need to be good at the ideation phase and the scalable phase? How do you test out if a product is going to be scalable?
Yeah, I think you're hitting on two different concepts, and maybe I can touch on both of those things. So one is what we used to call at Airbnb, do things that don't scale at first concept, and then scale them later. So let's talk about that. And the other is this idea of it, that now that you're in scaling phase, what kind of skills, what kind of mindset, et cetera, you need to have to scale things. So let me start with the first one, which is do things that don't scale at first. So one of the things that Brian Chesky was taught early on, I forget where he learned from, but I think for someone at Y Combinator, which was
Paul Graham, do things that don't scale. Yeah.
Right? Do things that don't scale at first. And many people take that principle and say, oh, that's an operations optimization principle, meaning hire a bunch of operations people, they'll do some manual stuff. And that principle only applies to building products that have operation elements to it. I think that's a mistake. I think if you think about it, that principle also applies to software products. And let me explain why. So if you think about the ideation phase, you have to think unconstrained first. That's the principle that we follow. Now, when you think about unconstrained first, if you limit the selection criteria to only ideas that you already know how to scale, you're going to limit your vision of what is possible, right? So I think it was very clear back in the day that Brian Chesky and Joe Gebbia could do photography for a host in New York City. So they can put their profile photo on the home photo inside on Airbnb.com. But it wasn't clear to them how they're going to scale that service around the world. Now, if they, at that point in time, they would have made a decision saying, oh, we're not going to entertain this idea today because we don't yet know how to scale something, they would have lost the battle very early on. So the key in ideation phase is to think unconstrained, is to not have a selection criteria that says, oh, I don't know how to build something at worldwide scale on day one. And as a result, I will not even consider that idea. Instead, you want to open up all your ideas to all possibilities. I'll give you an example. When I was at Airbnb, we were trying to build lots of physical products. You know, what I mean by that is Airbnb has software products, but it also has physical products. When you stay in the home, Airbnb's product doesn't end when you put your phone down and the software is gone. It actually, in fact, I would argue, starts when you step foot inside that home. And the experience that home gives you is also the product of Airbnb. So we have this idea at Airbnb, which was software experience and then the offline experience. And that's an important piece. So we were building a lot of offline products in my Airbnb Plus GM role, where we were entertaining the idea of what would it look like to build a lounge where people, before the check-in happens, let's say your flight is at 6 a.m., your Airbnb home is not open till 3 p.m., what do you do, right? Why don't we put you in a lounge that we have built, right? So I actually don't know how to build hundreds of lounges around the world. So what would I do? Well, I can discard that idea and say, well, that's a bad idea, right? Or I can say, okay, I know one thing, which is in L.A., in this jurisdiction where a lot of hosts live based on data, I can actually build one lounge. You know, I know how to build one lounge, right? I can actually try that out. I can build the ideal experience around that lounge, send users to that product, the offline product, and get feedback around what that means, what it looks like for them, before I have figured out how to scale this to hundreds of cities around the world. And then I can, once that idea is proven, then I can try to iterate from that point onwards to scaling it over there. So I encourage product managers to actually do things that don't scale at first, try those things out, both in the software layer as well as in the offline layer. I'll give you an example. When I started Instagram shopping back in 2016, 2017, we had two operations people who would, instead of building the software, here's what we did, because we didn't have time. we would have the merchants send us the photos and tell us where they want to tag the product. Mm-hmm. And there'll be individuals who will actually manually tag that product. It wasn't an operations problem. I could have built the software on day one. We just didn't have the resources or the time to do that. And we wanted to launch. Mm-hmm. So we did things that didn't scale at first, but then we figured out how to scale that. The second piece of the puzzle, I think, is what happens when you're now scaling? So Brian, in one of his podcasts, I think mentioned that he called it a left brain, right brain analogy. He said, you know, ideation and building products is like the left brain thing, scaling it like a more analytical, data-driven thing is on the right side of the brain, something like that. But I think I'll do something simpler with it. What I would say is that when you're scaling products, you have to figure out a lot of things that generally you can ignore when you're doing the 0 to 1 piece, because you're trying to see a best experience liked by 100 users or loved by 100 users. And then you figure out how to scale that. And I think lots of new nuanced concepts over there, but the two that I like to talk about, one is around the idea of knowing your target audience really well. So just because you build it doesn't mean they'll show up. You got to have when you're doing a scaling strategy, you got to figure out who you're going to target first, second, third, fourth. And you got to have a methodical way of saying which user I'm going to reach out to and which user I'm going to try to convert in that phase. So that's one principle to follow. Don't just launch it and hope people will come. Have a very targeted approach of attracting users of a certain type that you want to attract in each phases of that scale. The second thing is, when you're going to scale, you're going to have systems breaking on you all the time. What I mean by that is, like when I was at Airbnb and even at Instagram, we were scaling so fast that things were breaking under the weight of that growth. That typically happens in a hyper-growth company. So I think figuring out how your technology infrastructure stays one step ahead of your scaling strategy is incredibly important. Many PMs actually ignore that piece and just focus on scaling without realizing how far can you put the current technology infrastructure. And oftentimes you have to actually pause, rebuild some of the pieces that are choke points, and then scale as well. So these are the two examples that I wanted to bring. But as you can imagine, scaling products is a pretty lengthy topic. But these are good ideas to anchor around.
Wow, those are amazing philosophy behind creating a great product. I love what you just said. In terms of finding the target audience first, how did you find the target customer for Airbnb launch or Instagram shopping? For Instagram shopping, was your original audience 25 to 35 years old women? Or for Airbnb, a lot of people probably already pre-planned their whole trip. They may not even need the launch services. How do you figure out who your ideal customers are? What are the thinking behind identifying those initial customers?
Yeah, I think that's a great question. I think both of these are two-sided marketplaces. Mm-hmm. And a good friend of mine, Lenny, wrote a lot of good stuff around how to bootstrap two-sided marketplaces. It's a great article and everybody should read it. But let's start with the basic assumption that you have a two-sided marketplace, where there's a supply side, somebody's selling something, and there's a consumer side where somebody's buying something. And Airbnb and Instagram shopping are exact examples of that. I think the first and foremost thing you have to figure out is who do you start with as a seed on the supply side? Like without any supply, there isn't any consumer, right? And that's my belief. I mean, of course, that belief is not accurate all the time, but majority of the time, there are marketplaces that have started on the supply side first, bootstrap the supply and then scale. And as Lenny points out, there are some marketplaces that start on the consumer side and the supply came later on. But let's call it the 80-20 rule. And let's say most marketplaces have to start on the supply side. So it's incredibly important to understand who you're going to bring on board. So in case of Instagram shopping, we, for example, made a bet to go with some of the known brands as opposed to some of the unknown brands. We said, okay, we're going to start, I think W calls it the Goldilocks strategy, you know, which idea is that you start in the middle as opposed to starting at the top extreme, meaning if you go with Macy's, it's going to take you many quarters to launch. If you go with a no-name merchant, no user will come. So Goldilocks strategy is starting somewhere in the middle where people are known enough and you can bootstrap that. So that was our strategy for Instagram shopping. For Airbnb Plus, as an example, we started with homes where the hosts were already exceeding what we wanted every host to exceed. So we looked at the marketplace and say, okay, let's start with hosts that we know are already delivering on hospitality, already delivering on great customer experience, and start to convert them into an Airbnb Plus host, because that is what is in demand from the consumer side. So you got to figure that piece out as well. The second piece I would say is you have to understand is on the consumer side as well, if it's an existing user base that you're targeting, so I'll use Airbnb Plus as an example, instead of going out of Airbnb and attracting a net new customer, what we did was we built Airbnb Plus homes, the supply side, and then we targeted existing users who have come to Airbnb, but either didn't find a home that fit them because the supply didn't exist, or had a bad experience with an Airbnb home, but now this product will serve that better. So we could have taken two stances. We could have said, okay, let's go and attract the person who never comes to Airbnb. That is a pretty daunting endeavor. And we want to get there. We want to have net new customers as well. But in the beginning, to bootstrap this system from a 0-to-1 perspective, we start with them. And once we had a product market fit in that realm, it was much easier for us to expand beyond that customer base to now start attracting net new users. For example, we actually started advertising Airbnb Plus homes on Google search and other places to attract somebody who'd never tried Airbnb before, but this product will appeal to them. So let's bring them over there as well. So you got to figure out, this is what I mean by a step-by-step scaling strategy, because the product you're going to build will not appeal to everybody on the universe. And you got to be very clear about who are you building the product for, who are you going to go sell it to first or bring in to the system first. And once you have product market fit, continue to iterate from that point onwards to scale.
Totally. It's so important to find the initial customers before figuring out the ways to scale. You started working at big tech companies and product as a PM. Compared to now, you're in the management position as a VP of product. What's the differences between being a PM versus being a product leader?
I think I would describe this more as a spectrum. So I always tell people this jokingly, but there's some truth to this joke, which is I get paid to use my intuition and judgment. Because every decision that I made could be solved with pure data, you don't need me, right? You can just run your own analysis and say, what can you do, right? And the funny thing is the worldview that I see is so complex and has so little data that you have to oftentimes look at data, but more importantly, have an intuition or a gut around where you want to go, and we have the conviction and the courage to make that. So that's how I would describe my role at both at Airbnb and over here as well. As like I get paid to make judgments and decisions based on intuition, because it's the world isn't that easy to construct just from pure math. There's a lot of ambiguity around here. Now, when you're starting off in your career, I think we tried, at least at Coinbase, Airbnb, I think even at Instagram and Facebook, if I remember correctly, you start in your career, you get a very well-defined scope, a very well-defined product charter, et cetera. You have a manager who is investing a lot in you and spending a lot of time with you. But as you grow in your career, you're expected to take on more ambiguous things. So for example, when you're going from IC3, 4, 5, as you get more and more senior, you're beginning to take on problems that are not that well-defined. And by the time you're a VP or somebody else, you're basically taking on problems where there's probably no solution that you can just see just by looking at it. You have a lot more ambiguity. So one dimension of this career growth is the dimension of ambiguity. Starting junior or early on in your career, you are very well-defined scope. As you get more and more senior, whether it's product management, IC role or management, things just get more and more ambiguous. The other is the role of autonomy, which is you're expected to operate as you get more and more senior in your career, more and more autonomously. Let me explain what I mean by that. That doesn't mean that I can't ask for help. Like I can always ask for, I can go to Brian Chesky, Brian Armstrong, anybody that I work with in my job and ask for, hey, I don't know how to solve it. Like, let's just brainstorm this. That doesn't mean that I'm doing something wrong. What that means is that I'm expected, as I'm getting more and more senior, to be more and more autonomous. So ambiguity is increasing, autonomy is increasing. And those two things are pretty interesting if you think about it. There's less obvious answers, but you're expected to operate in those less obvious fields pretty autonomously. So that's the one framework to think about these things. And as you get through your career, the scope of responsibilities also increases, meaning the surface area of the product that you're touching is also larger. The number of users that are touching the surface area is also probably larger. So that's the way I think about a person's career trajectory or career journey rather in product management.
Yeah, wow, I really like that. When you get more senior, there are more ambiguity and autonomy. You have worked with some of the most iconic leaders and founders who are running Instagram, Airbnb, and now Coinbase. What are some characteristics do you think they have in common? And what are some qualities or behaviors that you have absorbed into your daily routine?
Yeah, I think that there are a couple of things I've learned with founders, working with founders, one of which is unconstrained thinking. I think one of the biggest traits of founders that I've found, successful founders that I've found, is that they have this uncanny ability to think in an unconstrained world. They can imagine a world devoid of the constraints that many people put on their own brains when they think about a problem space. Mm-hmm. And that's something that is very inspiring, but also very intimidating, right? If you think about it, one of the constant feedback that I get from my directs is that, you know, your ideas are very big and they can sometimes be overwhelming because we feel like, I don't know if you can get there or not. So it's a constant thing that I try to embody is when I look at problems, when I look at what we're trying to do, creating a vision, I try to stay on the side of unconstrained thinking, big, bold vision. That doesn't mean that when you execute, you're not taking an MVP approach. Of course, you're going to start small and go big. But when you're envisioning the problem space, when you're envisioning what needs to get done, you're thinking unconstrained. So that's one thing I love about founders. They are able to think unconstrained. The other thing that I've learned is the idea of resiliency. I think we often in Silicon Valley, we don't talk a lot about individual traits as much as we talk about skills. I think skills like, you know, coding, presentation, whatever that might be, hard skills. I'm talking more about resiliency, which is something that I've seen a lot in founders. So I'll give you Brian Chesky as an example. I consider him to be the Rocky Balboa of Silicon Valley. And he's been punched, like him and his company has been punched many times. And he's always come back and say, all right, round, another round. Let's start all over again.
Oh,
let's
do another round.
And he's very inspiring in that. I remember when this is January, February of 2020. This is, we're about to go IPO. We're all very excited. And then this thing comes, coronavirus, you know, it hits the business really, really bad. And I still remember how Brian went through that. He probably went through crazy times as an individual, but as a leader, when he showed up with courage and conviction. And it was really inspiring to see that because everywhere around him, things were getting destroyed. Like he went to a podcast and said, you know, it took me 10 years or so to build this company and 12 weeks to destroy it, kind of analogy. And because it really affected the business a lot. So what I've learned about these founders is that the idea of pushing through in the face of adversity is an incredible skill set. And many people give up. Ryan Chesky used to tell me a lot, such as the magic is in the last 1%. You know, let's say you create a document. Let's say you create a product. You get to 99%. And then you give up. All right, that's good enough, right? And Brian used to push me and say, look, the last 1% is where magic's going to happen. Push yourself in the last 1%. And I think that ability to push in that last 1% is incredibly inspiring and it's incredibly productive. Like, I mean, you look at everything that Brian Chesky has done and Airbnb have done, it is the magic of the last 1%. You know, he doesn't give up until the last 1% is taken care of. So to summarize, I think unconstrained thinking, it inspires me and something that I try to embody a lot in my own leadership style as well, product management style as well. And then resiliency, which is things are not going to go as planned, you know, but the fact that things are not going to go as planned doesn't mean you don't have a plan. You got to have a plan and you can change that plan when things don't go as planned, but you got to have the resiliency to go through that and go through that last 1%. That is where the difference between victory and just so much success lies.
I have a question about resiliency. How do you know if you're being resilient or you're just being really stubborn? When plan A didn't really work out, do you just keep going or do you find another way to go about that problem? How do you know when to quit?
I think there are two aspects here. One is when to know that you should pivot and do something else. And the other is, while you're still pivoting, do you have the resiliency as an individual to continue to pivot? So I think those are the two dimensions on which I can talk about. One is, how do you stay grounded and humble enough to know that what you're working on might not work out? And then you pivot and change and go in a different direction. The other is, many startups did not succeed with the first idea they came up with. They had to pivot many, many times. But what many founders who did succeed had was the ability to persist through those pivots. many, many times. And it's the same story with Airbnb as well, or for Instagram, or for Coinbase for that matter. And I'm pretty sure same story for many of the successful companies where founders kept trying things out. They didn't work out. They didn't give up. And in spite of that, because of their resiliency, their determination, they kept going through it, and eventually they found success around that. So mm-hmm. I will separate the two concepts in there. I think when to know to pivot versus keep pushing, it's a million-dollar question. You know what I mean by that is, mm-hmm. it is a very hard thing. And just like I mentioned earlier, I can't show you what grit looks like. You have to experience it. I can't write a few bullet points to say this is what a great spec looks like, mm-hmm. or this is what a great memo looks like. I remember in one of the letters that Jeff Bezos wrote, he said, when executives join Amazon, there's no memo that describes how to write great memos, mm-hmm. because you have to feel and experience what a great memo looks like. So what he does is it makes them sit through many memo meetings. And by the end of that stuff, they're like, oh, that one was a great memo. This wasn't a great memo. So that's experiential learning in many regards. So I think going back to the same thing, I think this is a million-dollar question because there is no playbook to decide when to quit, when not to quit. What is important is what I mentioned earlier. How do you separate your own hubris from and humility to figure out who you're listening to? This goes back to the idea of who are your board of advisors, you know, whose advice you trust. Right. So I think during the coronavirus time, Brian Chesky went to many of his respected people, including Obama and many of the people in the board of directors as well, to seek advice, you know, because you don't know what you don't know. And to be honest, there is nobody who knew how to navigate coronavirus. No company knew that. Right. We all had to invent that as we were going through that. So I think it boils down to whose advice you trust, who are your trusted advisors to decide what to do, how humble you are to look at what the signal the customer is giving and accept mm-hmm. it, right? That is also an important piece. Now, mm-hmm. That cuts both ways. I've seen many people push through that, even in spite of customer rejection, until they found the right customer who loved the product they were building. So long way of saying to answer your question is like, it depends. There's no science over here. There's an art and science element over here. And it literally boils down to a couple of things you can do for yourself, which is how do you round off your unknown unknowns through mentors and advisors that you trust? And two, how humble you can stay to separate your own hubris from reality and be mm-hmm. able to persist through that.
Yeah, totally. What's a typical day like for you as a former GM at Airbnb or VP of Coinbase? When you first accepted the job offer, what was the first day like for you at those companies? How do you identify the core problem you need to solve for your work? And how do you come up with the KPIs for yourself and your teams to solve it?
Yeah, I think the first and foremost thing when you show up in any new role is to understand the culture. Because everything, I always believe in this, which is everybody has access to the same information, mm-hmm. but the view they see is the view is determined by the lens they hold in their hand. And what I mean mm-hmm. by that is every company has a lens called culture. And mm-hmm. when they look at the world, they look at that world from the lens of their culture mm-hmm. as well. So my number one priority is to spend time with the founder, spend time with the other executives, spend time with mm-hmm. my own team and cross-functional partners, and literally understand how things get done over here. You know, mm-hmm. what is the culture like? What do we value? What do we don't value? How do we solve mm-hmm. customers' problems? And I'm more interested in that journey than anything else. The other thing I would say is my personal day, like I mentioned to you, I like to structure those things around my energy zones. So I will mm-hmm. Start off by meeting with customers. So I've met a lot of customers since I joined Coinbase. The same thing I did when I joined Airbnb as well. I'll give you an example. Because Airbnb's product is an offline product, mm-hmm. dog fooding that product meant that every Wednesday night, I stayed in an Airbnb home. So what I will do is I'll book the Airbnb home. Every Wednesday night, I'll go and stay in an Airbnb host's home because if I wanted to dog food the product, I needed to do that. It wasn't a software product only. I couldn't just dog food it on my phone. I actually had to live in those places to understand, stay in those places to understand what that product is like. So what I like to do whenever I take a new job is like dog food the product. And in case of Airbnb, that was a physical home. In case of Coinbase, it's a software product. So it's slightly easier, relatively easier to dog food that. So meeting with the customers is incredibly important. And I'll mm-hmm. spend a lot of time over there. And then mm-hmm. over a period of time, I will figure out what the strategy is. I also am not the kind of person who comes in and changes everything on day one without first getting full context around that. So So I'll spend a lot of time understanding that as well, and then work with the team to come up with the right strategy.
I love that you're trying to experience everything as a customer. Talking to the customer is one thing that many leaders said on the podcast. I believe the CEO of Skillshare and the former co-CEO of Chipotle both mentioned similar things. A separate question about competition. You've built some amazing products that has a lot of copycats. I guess one of the most popular one is probably Instagram shopping. I've definitely seen the buy buttons on so many picture-driven sites. What's your mentality like when your competitors are trying to copy your features?
Yeah, I think that there are many ways to build products. I have a slide on this that I presented in my interview at Airbnb, which is, as a product leader, how do I build products? And I had a slide that I actually put down different ways of thinking about it. The first way to build products is to look at your competition and just do everything that they're doing. I call it the feature neutralization strategy, which is, okay, XYZ has this feature, let's go build that feature, right? And I think that's one way to build that product, not the one that I advocate. The other way to build that product is to build it based on certain internal metrics, for example, revenue, right? Well, our job is to increase our revenue, hence the product we're going to build is all about revenue optimization, right? As an example. That's also a valid strategy, but not a very interesting strategy in my opinion. Mm-hmm. The best way to build product is what I learned at Instagram, which is literally obsessing over the customer's job to be done. I think one of the things that Mike Rieger and Kevin Systrom did was like stayed laser focused on that aspect. It's like to stay focused on the customer. So to answer your question, I think I'll definitely read about the competition and what they're doing and how they're doing things in a TechCrunch article or whatever that is. But there is no optimization. There's no activity that I'm doing to constantly look at competition and figure out what they're copying versus what we should copy from them. Because that is, in my opinion, personally, is not the right strategy to build great products. The thing that I have found very interesting is that the reason why companies eventually win is because they marry their superpowers with their strategy. Let me explain that for a little bit. Every company has certain superpowers. For example, when I was at Instagram, we had some superpowers, one of which was visual communication platform, right? That was a superpower, right? When we are at Airbnb, we had a superpower that our way of building products, which was obsessive over the last 1%, was a competitive advantage or a superpower that Airbnb brought to the table as well. So you want to have a strategy that is a winning strategy. And the combination of that strategy plus your superpowers is the unique thing you're creating to build the product. Let's take a couple of examples here. I mean, you can take any music streaming company, right? There are so many of them. Like Google is doing... YouTube has music, Amazon has music, Spotify has music, et cetera. But they all are bringing their superpowers in the execution of the strategy that they have chosen. Right? Everybody has a lot of selection, but the way that selection manifests is through the lens of their superpowers. Right? And I think that is that combination of a unique strategy, which, by the way, can be copied very easily, right? People can do exactly what you're doing. But what they can't copy is the unique superpower that you have. Mm. Every individual also has a very unique superpower. Every company has a superpower. So how do I define superpower? In case of a company, I define it as a certain set of unique combinations that only exist in that company.
Mm.
Right? That is something you want to bring to the market. I mean, otherwise you're basically saying, well, because X is doing this strategy, I'm going to do the same strategy. But what you want to say is that our strategies might be 80% the same, but what makes us unique is the superpower plus strategy combo that is so unique that nobody can bring to that market. And I think that's how you create winning products and winning strategies.
Yeah, I think it's also tied to building your personal mode. It's better to identifying and double down on your own core competency than copying your competitors. For founders and PMs who are listening to this, what are some tactical things they could do to improve their product building ability and their career in general?
Yeah, I think a couple of things I'll say. One is continue the unconstrained thinking. A founder's superpower is the unconstrained thinking, which is imagine an ideal scenario and work backwards from there. Imagine an ideal outcome for your customer and work backwards from there. Two is be ruthless about execution. I think one of the things that really separates the, so to say, the successful ones and not the successful ones is they're very ruthless about execution. Like I will tell you, like Brian Armstrong is one of the most amazing executionist that I've seen, because he is obsessively focused, not just on the idea, but how to actually make that idea come to life. So mm-hmm. don't just be in la la land, in the ideas at land. You got to come down from the clouds of ideas to actually put your energy, blood, sweat and tears, so to say, on execution as well. And I think honing your execution skills are probably as important as anything else that you can do as a founder.
Absolutely. I love it. Thank you so much. And we're in the 1 minute fire round session. So what's your favorite book?
It is by my business, my product and business book would be Competing Against Luck. That's a really good book that everybody should read. It'll help you build great products, even though it's not about software products. It's a great book to read. And my personal philosophical side of the house, I've learned think and basically what I've learned is that metaphysics is actually a thing. You know, mm-hmm. and there are many, many books. And actually, I would recommend Naval Ravikant's tweets. He does a really good job of synthesizing amazing books that I've read in that domain very easily. So instead of reading 17, 20 books, you can just follow his tweets and videos, and you're going to learn a lot about philosophy of life and how to be great in life.
Yeah, that's so funny. So
even though Naval is not a book, I would still recommend him.
Yeah, I saw like people screenshot his tweet on LinkedIn as their LinkedIn post. So like sometimes I saw it. Yeah, they're the tweets are great. So who made the biggest impact in your career?
Who made the biggest impact on my career? I think on a personal front, I think my wife, she has been very supportive. I always tell people you can't build great careers and have a great mm-hmm. family unless you have a mm-hmm. partner who supports you in that. So mm-hmm. I think that's, mm-hmm. that person has played an incredible role. And then I'll give props to somebody who was my first manager in my career, mm-hmm. Sashi, back in Microsoft India. And he fundamentally mm-hmm. changed my trajectory as well, because he took me under his wings and taught me things that you would never, like he was a GM of the entire India office of Microsoft, mm-hmm. but he took me, a newbie, under his wings and taught me a lot. So I still remember those conversations that probably helped me the most in my first job, but I didn't know anything, you know, but he believed in me and invested in me.
Yeah. Who would you invite to your dinner party?
I'll invite two friends of mine, Sanjay Raman and Dan Kim, because those dinner parties will be so much fun. You guys don't know them, but they are the funniest people alive, in my opinion. They're my friend circle. They both work at Airbnb with me, and I love having fun dinners.
Yeah, Airbnb. So yes. I guess, where can we find you outside of work?
You can find me in my home gym. You know, I love working out. I have a Peloton. I have a full gym set up in my area. And when I'm not working, when I'm not spending time with my family, that is where I love spending time.
Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for coming on the show, Sanchan.
I'm excited. I'm happy to be here. Thank you very much for inviting me.
All right. That's all we have for today. Thank you so much for listening to this episode of Smart Venture Podcast. If you like it, please leave us a quick review and hit subscribe so you don't miss any tips from the experts. If you want to receive our updates, please leave your email at smartventurepod.com. If you want to connect with me, all my socials are at GraceGongGG. Besides LinkedIn, it's just Grace Gong. I'd love to connect with you and let me know your thought about the show. Now you can also listen to Smart Venture Podcast on YouTube. Go to smartventurepod.com, click the YouTube link on the top banner. Don't forget to hit subscribe and smash the like button. See you next time.